Good morning and welcome to Episcopal Church of the Transfiguration on this Sunday, October 11th. I'm so delighted you're joining us for this act of virtual worship. And if you are visiting us today, I want to ask you to take just a moment to reach out to Anne Schmidt. Her email address appears at the bottom of the screen. Anne helps us greet more personally those who are visiting us in this online format, but we rely on you to email her first. And so I hope that you'll take just a moment, say a little hello, she'll follow back up with you, learn more about you, and hopefully have a chance to tell you more about our mission and ministry here at Transfiguration. Friends, formation, Christian formation for all ages continues today. We have classes for children, youth, and adults. There is something for everyone here, a way to grow your mind as well as your heart and your soul. And so I invite you to check out transfiguration.net/grow for a full listing of all the offerings happening on Sundays and midweek as well. A reminder that you can register to join us in person. Each Sunday morning at 9 a.m., we gather out on the South Lawn, just outside the South Transept here, for a live in-person outdoor celebration of the Eucharist. We cap that at about 75 people, so registration is essential and required. And you can find that at transfiguration.net/outdoors. I know I'm speaking on behalf of all those who've gathered for our first three sessions, our first three editions of that outdoor service, to say it was a remarkable joy to gather with fellow members of this church to pray and to praise God together in person. So I hope you'll come and join us soon. Hopefully by now you have received your Sharing Our Story materials, our pledge packet for the 2021 stewardship season. We are going to need everyone's strong support to ensure this church can maintain our loving witness for the kingdom of God next year. And so please be on the lookout for that packet if it hasn't already arrived. Next Sunday, October 18th, I invite you to bring your pledge card here to the church in person. Next Sunday will be our in-gathering celebration, as well as a communion Sunday. It's happening a week early in the month of October because we wanted to connect the act of celebrating and sharing communion as a whole church with this act of offering our pledges of support and being gathered together into one body in that way too. So next Sunday, October 18th, you're invited to come between 11 and 1, drop off your pledge card, pick up communion, and then find a parking place in the parking lot to join us for a great big Fig Fest tailgate party, complete with live music and an ice cream truck. We would love to have you join us. You need to register for this so that we know you're coming. Transfiguration.net/communion will direct you to the registration page, but I hope that you will come and be with us for that great ingathering and Fig Fest celebration. All right, friends, our worship today will begin in just a moment with the chiming of the bells. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's reign, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin. The palace of aliens is a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will glorify you. Cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a refuge to the poor, a refuge to the needy in their distress, a shelter from the rainstorm, and a shade from the heat. When the blast of the ruthless was like a winter rainstorm, the noise of aliens like heat in a dry place, you subdued the heat with the shade of clouds. The song of the ruthless was stilled. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul, and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel. Together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, as I say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness. where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. The Gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Several years ago, I attended a Taizé service at the Canterbury House at SMU. A friend invited me, and trusting her assurances it was my kind of service, I accepted without a clue what a Taizé service was. Had she told me songs and scripture would lead to a period of prolonged silence for contemplative prayer, I'm not sure I would have accepted so readily. I'm glad she didn't mention it, for in the silence of that service, I heard the still small voice of God speak to me of love deeper than I had ever imagined and call me to share that love with the world. In that moment, I knew everything would change. My priorities, my activities, maybe even my vocation. That God was calling me to a new life was clear. What was unclear was how to accept that call faithfully. I'd recently taken a formation class, and I'd learned about spiritual direction, in which one Christian listens deeply to another, walking with them and equipping them to pay attention to God's personal communication, to grow in intimacy with God, and to respond by living into the consequences of that intimacy. I made an appointment. At our first meeting, I shared my story, how I'd been raised in a Christian home, lapsed for a while as a teenager, and found my way back to the church. How I'd felt called to law, called to use my voice to speak for those whose cries for justice were not heard. I shared the pieces of my story that, at least in my own mind, seemed to connect with that encounter I'd had with God, the one that had brought me to direction in the first place. And finally, somewhat tentatively, I shared the story of sitting in silence at the Canterbury House and hearing the still, small voice that signaled to me that everything would change. Now, if you know me much at all, you know that what I expected from my spiritual director in response was, well, direction. Like crystal clear interpretation of what had happened with step-by-step instructions about what to do next. Mm-hmm. And if you've ever met with a spiritual director, you know I was sorely disappointed. Her job was to guide me in spiritual discipline so I could interpret what had happened and discern with God how I was to proceed. Read Philippians was the only direction she gave me that day. Read it slowly. Read it not as a letter from Paul to ancient Christians, but as one from God to you today. When you come to a passage, a word, or a phrase in which you hear that still small voice speaking to you again, stop there and sit with that passage for a long time, maybe for a day or two. If you finish the whole letter in less than 2 weeks, start over, you went too fast. Friends, we've been reading Paul's letter to the Philippians now for a month, as we've reflected on sharing our stories with one another and with the world. We didn't read the opening lines, the ones that grabbed me way back then and held me for days. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace. I spent a day right there, God's favor toward us, unearned, undeserved. Grace to you. Grace to you. Grace to you. Paul's letter to the Philippians is full of God's grace. Church tradition holds that Paul wrote from a prison cell in Rome shortly before he gave his life as a martyr for Christ. The church at Philippi was one of the first he had planted, and they were a model of Christian community. They gathered faithfully. They shared the good news of Jesus Christ boldly, and they supported Paul with their time, their talent, and their treasure. While he was imprisoned in Rome, they sent one of their own, Epaphroditus, to minister to him. And so Paul learned of the growing threat of persecution in Philippi, learning that he and they faced the same threats. Paul's letter to these Philippians is striking. Despite his circumstances, he uses variants of the word joy or rejoice at least 15 times in just 5 short chapters. And because of their shared context of Roman oppression, Paul's rhetorical style in this letter is at its simplest. We all know Paul can write some complex sentences full of dependent and subjunctive clauses into which he packs powerful theological punches. And yet here, when his life is on the line and he writes what could be his final words to this cherished church, Paul uses the simplest of language, modeling in his literary style the very point that he wants them to hear. We see this perhaps most clearly in the passage before us today. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown. What a remarkable way to describe his friends. My joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord. And then come the words which wash over me like waves of the sea every time I read them. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. If ever there were a time we needed to hear these words, it is now. We are gathered this morning, some in our homes watching this service online, and others outdoors with masks on our faces and 6 feet between us. We are in the pang of a pandemic. We are nearing the eve of an election. We are exhausted from months of anxiety, electronics, isolation, odium, and uncertainty. When we manage to gather, most often online, and set out to share our stories, I'm afraid we're inclined to speak of things like how 2020 has felt like a decade rather than a year, how we've been coping, or more to the point, failing to cope by stuffing our faces and filling our glasses and remaining indoors. We are all beaten down, aren't we? And Paul's letter to the Philippians is just what we need. He calls us to rejoice in God always, in everything. Gordon Fee, a New Testament professor and scholar in Vancouver, says that joy, unmitigated, untrammeled joy, is, or at least should be, the distinctive mark of the believer in Christ Jesus. And joy ought to categorize our lives, characterize our lives, rather, whether we are particularly happy with our circumstances or not. Rejoice, says Paul. And that imperative, together with all the others in this passage, like don't worry and let your requests become known to God, they're all in the second person plural. Rejoice, y'all. Don't worry, y'all. Christians and our communities are to be characterized by joy. But of course, if we as a community are to reflect joy to others, then each of us must experience that joy ourselves. Right? We've all been in that situation where we're with someone who is anxious and that anxiety spreads like a virus. So what are we, who have so many reasons to be anxious right now, what are we to do to experience this joy of which Paul speaks, which seems so easy for him no matter what his circumstances? Well, he gives us an answer in the text. When we are tempted toward anxiety, Paul directs us to share not our stress, but our gentleness. Let your gentleness be known to all. And that word he uses, gentleness, in the original language, it carries a sense of fairness that comes from relaxing overly strict standards. That's a good word for us today, isn't it? In times of anxiety and stress, be gentle with yourselves. And let that gentleness be known to all. Which begs the question, if we're called to share our gentleness with everyone and not our stress, what do we do with all the stress? Well, Paul says, let your gentleness be known to everyone and let your requests become known to God. Herein lies the good news for us today. Because following this path, letting our gentleness be known to everyone around us and making our requests known to God, we receive the peace of God which passes understanding. And this peace, it's not an ephemeral emotion. It's not an adjective that describes how we feel at one moment or another. No, as Paul uses it, the peace of God is a noun. And look at the verb that Paul uses with the peace of God, the actor in this sentence. The peace of God will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. There's a militaristic tone to the word, so much that Fred Craddock translates it as, the peace of God will stand sentry over your hearts and your minds. You almost get the sense that Paul came to this word for this sentence by looking up from his letter writing and gazing out the bars of his cell at a sentry who, no doubt, was standing guard at his own door. We who seek to share our stories with one another and the world would do well to spend time with Paul's letter to the Philippians, to read it as God's letter to us, listening closely as God speaks into our heart words of grace and peace and joy. In our formation hour today, we'll reflect on holy listening, for sharing our stories is supported when we know how to listen to one another's stories. This week, I suggest we all get a little listening practice through this remarkable letter written so long ago, through which God still speaks directly into our unsettled hearts and minds today. Amen.
Amen. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made.
For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary,
and became truly human.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate.
He suffered death and was buried.
On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven
and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead,
and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father,
who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified,
who has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy, catholic, and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead
and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors,
and for those who are alone.
For all who struggle during this time of sickness and separation.
For all doctors, nurses, researchers, and medical personnel.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice,
freedom, and peace.
For those in positions of authority, and all who stand for election.
For all who work to ensure safe and fair elections.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in the church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
For a spirit of respect and understanding to come over our divided nation.
Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins.
Have mercy upon us, most merciful God. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you, Jim.
Peace be with you, Rebecca. Casey. Peace be with you, Jim. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please join with me in a general thanksgiving. God of all mercies, we your children give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your presence that as we endure this time of sickness and separation, we may continually show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Savior, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages.
Amen.
Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you this day and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.